art. As you have heard many times in this school, the quantum measurement problem has been around since the birth of the quantum theory. It's nothing new. Many proposals have been made in trying to understand it, and lots of people have contributed to different viewpoints of the same problem. And still, it has remained unsolved, or rather, I should say, not very well understood. The revival in the interest to look at the problem actually has been motivated by experimental results. Because now the technology has progressed to an extent where one can individually look at bits and pieces of various aspects of the problem and then decide which is the correct viewpoint. And that has basically narrowed down the choices about what all can happen or what all things may be hidden under this particular problem. So I'm going to talk about a particular scenario which I consider the most important step in understanding this problem, and is essentially that arises because of its strong connection with experimental results. So the work I am going to describe builds up on this old, more than 30 years ago, paper of Nicholas Jisson. Some part of it is written up in here, and the other part is still unpublished, which includes the experimental results. And today I'm going to basically give the theoretical framework and the experimental data and its analysis I will present during the conference part of this particular meeting. So let me start at the beginning, textbook quantum mechanics. It generally quotes two axioms. One of them is a unitary evolution specified by the Schrodinger equation. It gives a evolution that is continuous in time, reversible, and deterministic, and it evolves pure states to pure states. Completely different axiom is given for measurement, typically a projective measurement described by von Neumann's prescription, where the wave function basically reduces to one of its components. And P are the usual projection operators, which basically square to identity, or square to themselves. And if you sum over all the projectors, it gives identity. This step is discontinuous, it's irreversible, and the choice of I is probabilistic. It still evolves pure state to pure state because the final result is an eigenstate of the measurement operator, and it is logically consistent on repetition in the sense that if I measure a particular observable on the system, and immediately after that I measure the same observable on the same system, I get the same answer. Once you reach an eigenstate, you keep on repeating, nothing changes. What particular projectors appear is actually defined by the observable, or more appropriately, the eigenstates provided by the measurement operators. But there is no prediction for which I that will occur in which experimental run. And this is the sense of the measurement problem, that I can do a single experiment, I can observe a result, but I cannot predict what will come out. What we have instead is an ensemble interpretation. It says that one run of the experimental is not enough. You do it over and over again, and then you calculate probabilities about how often which result is obtained, and those probabilities have a definite answer given by the bound rule. And as far as the ensemble dynamics is concerned, this is a tremendously successful prescription. There is no reason to doubt that this thing works. But the consequence of an ensemble is that a pure state ends up becoming a mixed state when you average over many runs. And then the expectation values are obtained as many averages of various quantities over this whole ensemble of runs. So this is a dichotomy between unitary deterministic evolution and probabilistic projective evolution. Many people have tried to merge these things together without success. In particular, there is no way to take a continuous reversible process and turn it into a discontinuous probabilistic process. What has been emphasized in lots of approaches is trying to get a handle on what do you mean by these particular probabilities. But that is not the line of attack I'm going to take to study this problem. I'm going to attack the part where there is a discontinuity. The reason being that in physics, we really don't have any discontinuous process. Everything is continuous at some level or the other. And can we make this measurement process continuous? The experimental technique which allows us to do that is that setup of weak measurements. What do I mean by weak measurement? Just take the system and the apparatus and make the coupling between the two very small. Of course, there is a correlation created by the coupling or the interaction between the system and the apparatus. But if I make the coupling small, the development of the correlation slows down. And if I make the coupling sufficiently small, the projection, which is essentially a step function, must get rounded off into some smooth crossover. And the question is, one, can we observe this crossover? Technology now says yes. And second, the theory, can we describe this crossover? That is what I'm going to address. The conventional description of textbook quantum mechanics does not have a description of this crossover. It requires new ingredients, but I'm going to keep the new ingredients to a minimum and see how far can I go. So before that, there are lots of words thrown around in this subject, and let me define some of them. One is called decoherence. What happens in decoherence is actually the system interacts with its environment. Environment has lots of degrees of freedom, and there is no real way to shield anything from the environment. And in the process of decoherence, basically there are scattering events between the system and the environment. These events are essentially elastic scattering. So what happens is none of the amplitudes or the magnitudes actually change, but the phases get affected. They are called scattering phase shifts. So all the phases get randomized. If I don't know the details of all the scatterings, I have to basically average over all the scatterings which may have taken place. If the scattering essentially and the randomizing phases, and if I observe a system over a time interval which is much larger than the time scale of scattering, then I have to essentially look at the observed quantities over a long time as a time average over many scattering events. Phases are randomized, and the average over random phase is zero. I mean, the density matrix, the diagonal elements are real. No phases will ever appear there. But all the off-diagonal elements are phases. So when you average over those large number of scattering events and cancel the phases to zero, the density matrix becomes diagonal. And this is the understanding of decoherence as a effect of large number of unknown interactions with the environment. What I have done is averaged over the environmental interactions, but I have not done anything to the system. So in the decoherence, every single copy of the density matrix changes to the diagonal form. It's still not ensemble. It's one system with many events of the environment. I have averaged over the environment, but I have not averaged over the system. So you can end up with a diagonal density matrix, and that has been a good success. People have actually calculated the rates of scattering events. You can very well estimate with all the known parameters of any experimental condition, and those scattering timescales turn out to be extremely short. So it is very much justifiable that you can average over many of those events. The measurement actually requires little more than that, that you never observe this density matrix in the instrument. When you measure, you will either get one eigenstate or the other. And this process is a jump. How do I get to from this density matrix to this density matrix for a single copy? You can do it at the level of ensemble and bond rule, but how do I do it at the level of single copy? And this process is also described by the word collapse. Collapse may or may not go through decoherence, but it somehow ends up from here to here. And that is a sort of set of terminology which I will essentially stick to. Some other words. When I describe interaction with decoherence, it already chooses what is called a preferred basis, the basis in which the density matrix becomes diagonal. That is dictated by what kind of interaction with the environment is there. Sometimes it is also called a pointer basis. There is something which is called a von Neumann non-demolition interaction. Is also a part of the decoherence paradigm, and what it does is it's a unitary interaction with a well-defined Hamiltonian which can be experimentally realized easily. That for every state of a system, one can transform the apparatus into a related state. There is no problem in doing that. But what this interaction produces in general is an entangled state when you have a system in a superposition. So for every component of the system, there is a corresponding component of the environment. You have not yet selected one out of those many components. And what I'm going to use this particular picture is to actually define what measurement is. The measurement is an interaction where for some reason or the other, the apparatus does not remain in a superposition of pointer states. If the apparatus is allowed to be in a superposition, what we will have is an entanglement. The system is entangled with apparatus. But for some reason, what we observe is that the apparatus is never in a superposition of pointer states. The pointer states are disjoint and you see only. And anything which does that, I will call a measurement. It doesn't matter whether it is a human observer sitting and looking at the instrument or not. If it happens in any way, it's fine. And to look at the process as a continuous evolution in time, I'm looking at a picture which many times is referred to as unraveling of quantum collapse. Quantum collapse is not an instantaneous process. It takes place over time gradually. And what this unraveling does, it produces the history during that measurement time. There are words, there is a quantum jump, which is usually the discontinuous and probabilistic version. And there is a quantum trajectory, which are actually continuous, stochastic, and tractable histories connecting the initial and the final states. And I'm going to basically describe how to construct these quantum trajectories and how to understand them. This framework which I said I will be using is a weak coupling between the system and the apparatus. It's generically under the label of weak measurement, but I'm not going to use any other property of weak measurement. In particular, I have no need to go into the discussion of what is a weak measurement. It's not needed. Just a small coupling and a long measurement time scale is enough. But it does raise lots of new questions which are not in the axiomatic framework of quantum mechanics. Here are a few. Can all measurements be made continuous? There are some problems with our languages, for example, when describing decays. How are you going to replace the projection by a continuous substitute? What is a local evolution rule during measurement? What happens if I don't complete the measurement and stop half the way? Will I get? And if I restart at the middle, the result depends on the middle point or the original point where I started? What kind of thing? Where is the ensemble? And if I do multipartite measurements on different parts, how will all these different trajectories come together? So there are lots of new questions, and I have to address them. The answers are important not only from the theoretical point of view, but for increasing the accuracy of quantum control and feedback. Because when you want to get a good control and achieve a good feedback, you need knowledge of what is happening in a particular experimental run which you are looking at, and not just a global average. You can understand what is going on in individual run, you can improve the efficiency, stability, all these kind of criteria. And since the result is probabilistic, I need to replace the projective measurement axiom by a continuous stochastic dynamics. So there is a standard formalism for stochastic dynamics. Can be realized by adding a random noise to some deterministic process, and it has been heavily studied in the context of Brownian motion and the Langevin equations. But if I want to do that, I have to follow all the constraints of quantum mechanics, which restrict what the stochastic process is. What are these constraints? I will list a few. The measurement has to be repeatable. So if I go to an eigenstate and I keep on measuring it, I should keep on getting the same answer, which means that the measurement eigenstates are fixed points of the evolution. If I go there, I cannot go anywhere else. So whatever is taking me to the eigenstate, as well as whatever the noise may be, both of those things have to vanish at those fixed points. And fixed point requires that the evolution dynamics will become non-linear. I have a linear dynamics, function will keep on changing, it will never stop changing. What is else? The probabilities have to be maintained during the evolution. That is to avoid any conflict with special relativity, because in special relativity there is no concept of simultaneity. I'm going to stretch out time scales and look at multipartite measurement, which happens first, which happens second, which one overlaps with what in which particular time frame. There is no unique answer to all those questions. And still, if I want to assign an unambiguous meaning to the measurement, there is one way out, that the bound rule is a constant of evolution. It holds at every single instant of time. Which one I measure first and which one I measure second doesn't matter. Or which I measure halfway, that also doesn't matter. Throughout the whole time evolution, it is a constant. And of course, it has to be constant, average over the noise, whatever will come in the stochastic process, because there is a noise is, in essence, creating the ensemble for me. The question is, can something be done which has this particular set of properties? And the answer is yes. The solution was written down by Nicolas Dizan. I'm going to describe this solution from a slightly different viewpoint and add some new things on top of it. Before I do that, let me give some important features which are buried in the solution, that the solution has two parts. One is the evolution towards the eigenstates, and the other is an unbiased noise. But the Born rule is reproduced only if the ratio of these two is a constant, fixed. If I change the ratio, Born rule will get thrown away. And this property is reminiscent of the fluctuation dissipation theorem, well known in statistical mechanics. Einstein demonstrated that this connection relates diffusion, a Brownian motion on one hand, and viscous damping on the other hand. They're quite different physical phenomena, but they are related because they originate in the same process, which is the molecular scattering. So both of these features a common origin, and so their magnitudes are related. And this Einstein relation was actually a strong demonstration of the kinetic theory much before the individual atoms could be observed. There is a common origin. And since the quantum dynamics will display a similar property, the question comes, are the noise and this attraction towards the measurement eigenstate are related by some common underlying feature? What it is, we don't yet know. White noise is a terminology where the noise is completely uncorrelated in time. So it is a delta function in terms of temporal correlation. If you take a Fourier transform, the Fourier transform of delta function is a constant, all frequencies present with equal strength, and that is called a white noise. Second feature is that the measurement dynamics is completely local between the system and the apparatus, independent of any other environmental degree of freedom. This also suggests that I can forget about the rest of the world, no need to worry about gravity or whatsoever. Whatever is happening, it will be between the system and the apparatus. Very strong constraint. And it, as I am saying, both are theoretical and experimental part. Today I'm going to talk about theory. Well, I will derive the description. In the next talk in the conference, I will present the experimental data and show how the theory matches with experiment. This relation is also an indication that the deterministic and the stochastic part have a common underlying origin. Same thing as viscosity and ground and motion. What is it's going to do is kind of depicted pictorially here, shows what I mean by trajectory. I start with some state, wanders around, sometimes it lands up at one eigenstate, sometimes it lands up at the other eigenstate. What happens here is a question of dynamics. There can be a geodesic component to it, there can be fluctuations to it, and I want to find out what the equation that dictates it, and the whole process of measurements will be looked upon as an effective process of some underlying theory which I can't fully specify, but it's an effective theory which is quite okay as long as I can give a correct mathematical description. And what this effective P-square will do, it will give us some idea about what may be lying beyond. It's a constraint. So I will skip this part. So now let us construct these trajectories. The first component, I'm just going to take the geodesic, which means I start with some initial state and go to an eigenstate. So it's an interpolation from an operator, which is identity, which gives the initial state, and a projection operator, which gives the final state. I keep the evolution completely on the unitary sphere, which is will give me a great circle. So I know what is a geodesic sphere is. And to keep the radius constant, I divide out by the normalization. Just a simple interpolation. S is a parameter. Goes from 0 to 1. It's very easy to expand this out in a small value of S and construct a differential equation. Easier to talk in terms of differential equation. And this is what the differential equation looks like. It's a nonlinear equation. The density matrix occurs quadratically on the right-hand side, but there are no higher order terms. Involves the projection operator and some coupling. This parameter S is a combination of coupling and time, and I just split it up into its two parts to make it similar to what is commonly used in evolution. Formalism, but T is some measurement time and G is some measurement coupling. What matters is actually only the product of it. So it's a nonlinear equation. And it describes the geodesic, but it has many nice properties. This is the equation for one particular eigenstate, which I called PI. General. Rho is a generic density matrix, P is a generic projection operator. So what does the equation have? It preserves pure states. Very easy to check. If rho square is equal to rho, then d by dt of rho square minus rho is 0. And that is essentially guaranteed because I took a geodesic. It was on the unitary sphere and it's remaining. Trace is also preserved, so trace rho is 1. Derivative of trace is 0. But the second property is a bonus. This was not expected in just constructing the geodesic, but it turns out to be true that projection operators are fixed points of the equation. If I put rho equal to pi, d by dt of rho is equal to 0. If I reach the eigenstate, I'm not going to move anywhere else. This is something which we need for the measurement. So it's good, but it just came out. As I said, it's a bonus. What next? Well, one thing I should say that the equation is much easier to write in terms of density matrix, and that's what I'm doing. Some people write it in terms of wave function, but it is much more cumbersome. What about multipartite system? Well, if I have two parts, say that the projection operator can be written as a tensor product of projection operator in one part and the projection operator in the second part, and if I don't observe one of these parts, I can sum over those parts and sum over the projection operator is one. Now this equation is linear in the projection operators. So if I sum over all the unobserved parts, that just disappears. It's completely decoupled from the environment. Doesn't matter whether there are extra degrees of freedom there or not. If I don't observe them, they do not influence any of the couplings. The coupling is dictated by the apparatus. Apparatus is always there. I cannot throw it out. But anything else, I can happily ignore, and it doesn't matter. One can work out what is the convergence to the fixed point. It turns out to be asymptotically exponential. Don't have to worry too much about it. And those who know a little bit about this kind of operators, I can say that this structure is actually a Lindblad operator, but with the roles of the system and the apparatus flipped. So it's a Lindblad operator where the system with its density matrix acts on the pointer. And there will be certain effect on the pointer. And what this equation says is that there will be an effect on the system which is negative of that. Some kind of action-reaction principle. This is a, well, mathematically it's an identity, and that is useful to understand lots of properties of this particular operator. But this says that there is something much more fundamental about this particular process. And I'm looking at actually decohering the apparatus and not the system. The apparatus I have to decohere because it cannot remain in superposition. I have to get rid of all the superposition of the apparatus. If I apply the system as an operator on the apparatus, there will be a back reaction and it will produce this particular effect. So there are many nice features this equation, but it doesn't have everything. And to get there, let me now actually it is superconducting qubits. Environment actually can be decoupled very well in the superconducting qubits. That's the reason it's a good candidate. But there is an interaction between the qubit, which is made up of Josephson junctions, and the cavity, which plays the role of the apparatus. The cavity is not a bath. It's actually a measuring apparatus. There is some effect of the rest of the world, but it can be made sufficiently small so you can see the system apparatus interaction clearly. So what I am going to do is consider an ensemble of this quantum geodesic trajectory, because I don't have one fixed point. I have many eigenstates, and each eigenstate will have a fixed point. And I have to worry about how often I go to which fixed point. That is given by the bound rule. Okay, so now let us take this equation, which has a single operator inside it, and combine it to create a simple superposition, the same operator, but summed over different fixed points with some weights. The weight will decide how often I go there. And some convention that sum of all the weights equal to 1, because there is already an overall constant g as a multiplicative strength. So this is a more general equation, but it still preserves the two properties which I mentioned, that rho square equal to rho and fixed point nature of each PI is true irrespective of what weights I choose. The weights are free quantities as far as these constraints are concerned. There is something else which is also buried in the equation, that I can look at the evaluation of diagonal versus off-diagonal elements. And it turns out that there is a strong relation between rate of change of off-diagonal elements and the rate of change of the diagonal elements. And that is basically, again, from the linearity of various operator. And so if I know the evaluation of the diagonal elements, I don't have to do any extra work to determine the evaluation of the off-diagonal elements. It's completely fixed. And for that reason, the free variables or free degrees of freedom are only the diagonal elements. If I solve for the evaluation of the diagonal elements, which are the bound rule probabilities, everything else is determined in terms of that. It's not, even though it's a density matrix, there are no n squared degrees of freedom, there are only n minus 1 independent variables. What happens actually is in this evolution, you can integrate it also very easily, that magnitudes of the off-diagonal elements shrink or change according to the magnitude of the diagonal elements, but the phases don't. So this is an evolution which changes the magnitudes of the off-diagonal elements without changing the phases, something which is completely complementary to what happens in decoherence. Decoherence didn't change the magnitudes, it changed the phases. And one can actually simplify the diagonal part and write it in a different way. What happens to the diagonal elements? Well, it depends on the various weights, but the way this formula has all the weights appearing inside them, it gets a term which is a weight of that particular trajectory minus the average weight over all the fixed points. This structure arises because I have the normalization trace rho equal to 1. So if I go somewhere, I have to basically prevent going from somewhere else. And as a result, there is a simple consequence that the linear equation in the diagonal elements, and if I just look at the weights which are larger than the average, those amplitudes are going to grow. The weights which are below the average, those amplitudes are going to shrink, and this is a generic feature, again, irrespective of what weights I stick in. I can always take a sum set of weights, define an average, and this is what happens. And all these features are actually also stable under small perturbations of rho, so don't have to worry about stability part. But this is a feature which is troublesome in comparing with the bound rule. But this is not what bound rule says. Bound rule will say that you should go to all the fixed points with some probability. You can't just go to the larger ones and forget about all the small ones. So that means something is not right about this equation. One can actually explicitly put in something which I call instantaneous bond rule, where the weight is just a trace of rho times p at that particular instant of time. The equation remains the same. You can actually define an average of these particular weights and do a little more calculation, but conflicts with experiment. And the part which conflicts, there are two things. One is, even though I constructed this equation, it is still deterministic, and it doesn't give me the correct probability. So how do I get around it? And that way is again known from statistical mechanics. What is happening is I'm just converging toward the closest fixed point, which has the largest weight. I want to not go only to the nearest point, I want to go all over the space. Basically, I have to add noise to the training. It just cannot be the shortest path, which is what geodesy. The question is that what is the property of this noise which I need to add? And there are two popular instances of noise. One of them is called white noise, which is used in diffusion processes, quantum diffusion, or Brownian motion, or Langevin equation. All those things are more or less the same thing. And another popular situation is what is called a shot noise, which corresponds to quantum jump. Either the process happens or it doesn't happen. It's like zero or one binary situation. So I'm going to add a noise to these weights and see what happens. To show the algebra explicitly, it is convenient to simplify to the case of just one qubit. So, this is, so far it was a general equation for arbitrary density matrix, but now I take the simplest system, one qubit. Whatever I had before simplifies to this equation for rho 0, 0, these are the W0 and W1 are the two weights. And off diagonal one is determined in terms of the diagonal one. Rho 1, 1 is 1 minus rho 0, 0 because of the trace. And the other off diagonal element is Hermitian conjugate. So there is only one equation I have to solve. Everything else is fixed. Only one independent parameter. And then the way I have chosen the normalizing, the two weights are also complementary, so one of them is specified, the other one is already determined by that. So now let us ask, what should I substitute inside here to get this density matrix so that the one element we have according to bond rule. So here is an instance of a white noise which is added on top of the instantaneous bond rule. So instantaneous bond rule is just the weight of that particular trajectory given by the density matrix. So for W0 it is rho 0, 0, W1 it is rho 1, 1. And then I'm adding a noise. And this root S is a normalization convention. It's called the spectral density. The intensity is square of the amplitude, so that's why the square root appears, but that is a convention. So root S basically controls how much noise I am adding to the geodesic model. And the definition of this white noise is average is zero, and the time correlation is a delta function. So the Fourier transform of the time correlation, as I said before, is a constant. All the frequencies appear with equal strength, and that is why it is called a white noise. So let me take this white noise ansatz and stick it in that equation, see what is the evolution. So what I get is a stochastic differential process solution to this equation. The equation is defined on the interval 0 to 1, that are the limits of the density matrix values, and the boundaries are perfectly absorbing. They are the eigenstate. If I go there, I can't move anymore. The trajectory will start somewhere and it will go to the boundary and get stuck. That's what the equation produces. Here are the some pictures, numerical evolution explicitly carried out. It so starts at 0.5, wanders around, and then gets stuck at one end or the other. So now, let us try to understand what kind of spectral density will do a good job. As I said, if I have no noise, then the density matrix evolves to the nearest fixed point, which means that the probability of going is basically a step function. If I on this side, I go there. If I on this side, I go down there. If I have only noise, which means large fluctuations, the situation is basically democratic. I go all over the place, and both sides are equally likely. The geodesic part is whatever bias is there can be ignored. And neither of them is a bound rule, but they are kind of extreme symmetric situation. And to figure out what will be an appropriate value of S for the bound rule, it's necessary or rather convenient to convert this differential equation which I wrote down from what is known as a Stratonovich form to the Itô form. And this is a technicality, but the reason for it is buried in this definition of the delta function. So the integral over delta function is 1, we know that. This is a delta function at t minus t prime. So if t and t prime are very close, that is what the infinitesimal evolution will need, the integral is 1 over some time interval delta t. And that means the magnitude of xi is actually behaving like 1 by square root of delta t. So this is square of it here, it gives 1 over integrated over delta t. So even though this is a differential equation, the first part will have a dt, but this one is scaling differently. It is scaling as a square root dt. And so if I want to integrate the equation, I keep a first order term here, but I have to expand this to second order in psi, because that is also going to contribute to order dt. So this is a technicality, but it always comes with delta functions that you have to be a little careful. And if you are careful and expand it out to the second order, you get a form which is called the Itô form of a stochastic process. And it now explicitly describes the evolution, which is I'm writing as a d rho, not as a derivative. It's a finite step in time, and which has these two terms. One of them is proportional to dt, and the other one is proportional to dw, which is the integrated form of the xi. And it is called a Wiener noise, and its property is that mean is 0, dw square is of the order dt. And this is a description, the Itô description, which is heavily used in describing random walks. So in Brownian motion, you write the Langevin equation, which is in Stratonovich form. But if you want to also write the random walk equation, it will be in the Itô form. So the random walk doesn't have any singularity. There are finite steps you take in any direction. So that is what the equation is. And now this equation has a very interesting structure. It has a coefficient of dt, which has this extra factor 1 minus g times s in front, and it has a factor in front of dw. And the factor in front of dt allows me to do something non-trivial. This term generically is called a drift of the stochastic process. It changes the variable as a function of time in some direction. And the second term is called the diffusion. So this is a mean zero, some distance, basically square of the distance is proportional to time, which is a property of random walk. And I can generate an equation which has no drift. If I do that, then the expectation value of d rho is 0. And that means bond rule becomes a constant of revolution. It doesn't change in the function of time. Bond rule defined by the expectation value of the diagonal density matrix elements. And to do that, the constraint is g times s equal to 1. This is a constraint completely on the interaction properties. It doesn't depend on the state. G was the coupling strength, and s was the magnitude of the noise. The two end up getting related. So bond rule is a very peculiar answer to this particular process in presence of a very special kind of interaction. One can look at it in a different ways. I wrote down this variable p of x earlier. You can write down the equation for it, and if you solve it, you will get a very simple linear equation. The solution is px is equal to x. That is a bond rule. And one can easily verify it by, as I said, doing numerical simulation, but without assuming this constraint g times s is equal to 1. And I will show you some result. And this is the probability as a function of the variable. Px equal to x is this diagonal line, which is bond rule. This zero line is where noise was equal to 0. It is a step function. If I on this side, I go this way. Other side, I go this way. If it is infinity, which means a large amount of noise, it's democratic. The whole thing is a constant. So it basically changes on this type of step to this type of step as a function of whatever values of GS I take. And GS equal to 1 is a very special solution, which is a diagonal evolution. So what more I can do with this equation? This is a Langevin equation, and there are standard techniques to convert it into the distributions of trajectories. So individual trajectory is divided by the equation, but if I want to give a distribution as an ensemble over the whole set of noise terms, it can also be done. Every Langevin equation can be converted to a Fokker-Planck equation, which doesn't have noise anymore, but it gives the distribution of the whole trajectory. And the equation which I wrote down, if I convert it to a Fokker-Planck equation, this is what it looks like. And it's convenient enough that even though this equation is also a nonlinear equation, it can be solved exactly. And what does it do? The exact solution, if you start with some initial value, it can be called a delta function at some value of rho 0, 0. The equation basically splits it into two parts. The areas under the two parts are conserved as a function of time. And one part goes to one boundary, the other part goes to the other boundary as a function of time. Basically, as if these things split and they never knew about each other. Just monotonically travel, and if you use the right variables, everything is a Gaussian. So it's a very simple mathematical structure. Initial Gaussian divides into two Gaussian, one goes this way, other goes this way. You can find what are the areas under the two curves, which are given by the probabilities. And the other part of the Gaussian is even simpler, that both of them have the same variance, and the shift in the mean is also the same. If you use a variable, which is here I've called the z, which basically maps this 0, 1 interval to minus infinity, the whole line. So it's a very simple solution. Two Gaussians moving at constant speeds, the width, sorry, variance is the same, heights are different, and they just monotonically do their own job. And the interesting part for the experiment is that this can be tested. If you you measure the intermediate steps, which are time slices of this distribution, you have a prediction. So if the weak measurement is going to observe this trajectory, I can collect an ensemble, find the distribution, and compare it with the analytical form. And the interesting part of that's what it looks like. Initial Gaussian, it kind of spreads out, and ultimately it becomes two boundaries. It's not a Gaussian on the 0-1 interval, but you convert it to minus infinity, it becomes Gaussians. And the most important part of this result is that there are no free parameters except for the evolution time. The whole curve is predicted. There are no parameters. The experiment can give me whatever it does, and I have to fit it only that what is the time instant where this distribution could be there. It's a very strong test for the formalism. Either it is wrong or it is right. Nothing much else. There is nothing to fiddle around with. And one free parameter has to be there because it's a time continuous process. I have to specify what time I am measuring. But that's it. And this is a sample of some old work where people actually saw these trajectories. These are some examples. And all I have to do, experimental technology progresses, is to measure the distribution at some particular value of time. These are just individual samples. I'm going to talk about that in the conference, what happens. But now let me tie up some other features that I actually obtained the whole ensemble of the trajectories. I can calculate expectation value. The expectation value can be calculated in two steps. First, I will just average over the noise, which will give me the average density matrix. And then the expectation value of any operator is a trace of rho times O. It's linear in rho, so I averaged over rho, it doesn't matter. I can calculate that as well. And what does the average over rho produce? It gives exponential decay of the off-diagonal elements. That's all happens. Diagonal elements don't change. The exponent is actually the g times t. This is a coupling times the time. This defines the rate of decay of the exponential element. And this behavior is identical to what is produced by the Lindblad master equation. Somehow I had a nonlinear equation, a complicated solution. I averaged over a noise, and it became a linear, same as the solution of the linear Lindblad equation. It all works. Mathematics is there, a little surprising, but that's what it is. And that's why this whole thing can be interpreted as a super operator, which is the terminology for master equation, and a super operator which is nonlinear. Still satisfy all the positivity properties. Nothing gets wrong anywhere. But dynamics is different. And that is perfectly valid as far as any mathematical objections have to be tackled. And that is one part of this dynamics. The other part is also a little unusual. I have the whole ensemble, so I can calculate the fluctuation. The d rho square is the size of the fluctuation. It is proportional to g square s times dt. Just take that equation and calculate it. And one can look at only the geodesic evolution term of that equation for leaving out the noise. It has this particular behavior. And the interesting thing is these two are proportional. This is the square of the fluctuation. This is the geodesic part of the evolution. If you take the ratio, this g and dt will completely cancel out when g times s is equal to 1. Otherwise, the s will be there in the size of the function. And this thing depends on the state because it's a nonlinear equation. But there is a relation in the size of the fluctuation and the size of the geodesic evolution, which is the same as this constraint of bond rule g times s. And when it is satisfied, this relation will depend on the evolution parameters of the components. So this is a unusual feature, because in general stochastic processes, a vanishing drift, which is d rho rho equal to 0, and the fluctuation dissipation relation, which are the proportionality between these two, are quite unrelated properties. But here, in this quantum trajectory dynamics, both of them lead to the same bond rule, which is a highly non-trivial feature. Why it is so, I don't have any answer yet, but I'm going through the mathematics and it's throwing up all these features. Okay. You can generalize to large quantum system, etc. Instead of a qubit, if I want to go to n-dimensional space, one can easily work out what these weights are in the language of this pattern generator of Hessian algebra, basically traceless components of all that diagonal Hermitian matrices, and normalization is such that with this definitions, the bond rule constraint is still g times s equal to 1. So you can handle multidimensional spaces, doesn't matter. There's other feature also, everywhere the combination g times t appeared, but since the bond rule was a constant of motion, can be immediately generalized where g is time dependent. What matters is only integral g dt. Whatever is independent of time doesn't get modified under the parameterization of time. So that is fine. It can be useful in an experimental situation where the couplings can be time dependent. There is no guarantee that the equation or the evolution of experiments is completely linear. Doesn't matter. One can actually simplify the analytic work a lot because whatever appears in the equation is only the second moment of the noise. So the Gaussian noise can be used. The formula may be a little more complicated. I can even go down to what is called a Z2 noise, where the noise has only two values, plus one and minus one. All that matters is the second moment, and I can calculate this more easily. And can also write all this in a Krauss decomposition form. So let me summarize all the features of this diffusion process. The trajectories are evolving unitarily, even in the presence of noise. Mixed state appear only when multiple trajectories are averaged over. Trajectory weights, which I just stuck in as wi, they are real, but they are not restricted to interval 0 and 1. This is a way quantum mechanics always comes back in some form or the other. These weights are not probabilities. And allow them to be negative, as in the case of Wigner functions or any general description of quantum dynamics, some state, phase space with some measure. One can call each particular history as the result of one particular experimental run. No problem with that. You can call it a many-world ensemble interpretation. That is also fine. There are free reparameterization freedom, but the only thing dynamically important is the time of measurement, and this time of measurement is dictated by the system apparatus pair, and for different system apparatus pair, this can be varied differently. And what I have is only the dynamics of the diagonal elements. You can add any non-trivial dynamics of the off-diagonal elements on top of it, but the two remain decoupled. So one can actually have this evaluation for the diagonal part and the decoherence for the off-diagonal part. They don't mix with each other, and then it is completely fine. Okay. So now let me come to a different kind of noise, which is called short noise, and kind of discontinuous process, but it's again used heavily in the literature to address problems which are defined in Fox space. Diffusion is completely okay in the Hilbert space, but many properties or other phenomena which require creation and annihilation of particles are defined in Fox space. And Fox space has a number operator which is not a continuous value. It goes 0, 1, 2, etc. So now to define a process in the Fox space where some creation and annihilation takes place is given in terms of this short noise, where this dn, which I'm writing as a differential, but it's either 0 or 1. It takes that either, say, in an atomic process, a photon is emitted or not emitted. I can't talk about half a photon. Our language gets basically messy, or rather, we don't understand what it means. Better to talk about either the photon is not there or there when the atom decays. Otherwise, it will be some superposition and some coefficients, but still the basis is taken so that this 0 and 1 are distinct number operator states. And so what is the dynamics for those kind of evolution? Well, all I have to do is take this geodesic part, which I'm not going to change. That equation was there. But the noise is now different. It is not the Brownian motion noise. It is this binary noise. And what does it do? This part is a continuous evolution. So it's a tenuing differential with respect to dt. But this one is discrete. And it causes a jump. Either I'm straight with zero photon, or at some instant, I will have one photon. I'm going to jump, then the coefficient of this thing will not be infinitesimal. It's actually order one. So this is written in a particular basis where one eigenstate basically has a continuous evolution, and the other eigenstate is reached by a jump. That is this particular scenario, which is common in the description of the short noise. And in that particular case, short noise contribution has to be d rho to becoming element which is minus rho. So whenever this becomes 1, that minus rho means that rho will suddenly become 0 all the way. Started somewhere, but it jumped all the way to 0. And that is the process. The geodesic part I'm not touching. I'm modifying the type of noise. What does it produce? Again, the equation is simple enough. For a single qubit, there is only one variable which is free. It has some dt part from the geodesic and some dn part from the noise. And this is a simple binary process because dn is either 0 or 1. So you can just solve the random walk very easily. The constraint of Born rule, which is the expectation value of d rho becoming 0, now becomes a constraint on the expectation value of the noise, which means how often the jumps will occur. Dn will describe a jump, but I have a control or other parameter about how often the jumps are occurring. I can't allow the jumps to occur too frequently, because otherwise the process will become something else. So it's typically described in the language of a Poisson distribution, where each small interval So the Born rule basically gives this relation, just take expectation value of 0 is 0, that dn is equal to dt. And that means if the time interval is small, the probability of dn being non-zero is also small. It's a Poisson process. And then there is an exact solution. Well, you have this constraint, you put this thing in. I know the expectation value of dn, which is the probability of this. I solve the random walk. And now the random walk is a superposition of two delta functions. So the original delta function splits into two, but these two pieces behave a little bit differently. One of the delta function is already at the boundary. You jumped all over there and then you are not going to move. And the other one keeps drifting slowly in the space. And the magnitudes of the two are also known in terms of the initial point, but the magnitudes of the two parts are not constant. The smooth parts keeps on decaying, and the jump part keeps on growing as a function of time. And one can plot this thing. They look very close to exponentials, though they are not exact exponentials. These are the kind of results for that. That is fine. One can also work out the full dynamics of what is the average density matrix going to do by looking at the off-diagonal elements. And it has same kind of behavior. Diagonal part doesn't decay, off-diagonal part decays exponentially, but there is a factor of two different in the decay constant, that is just because of the way I defined a particular normalization of the equation. But it's again a Lindblad process with a certain decay constant, a nonlinear equation, and average lower noise produces a completely positive map. We can also calculate the fluctuation dissipation relation. Fluctuation is proportional to dn of that equation. The geodesic part is proportional to dt. Once you put in the expectation value, these two things are again proportional, independent of value of the couplings. So this is again a mysterious connection that you can get bond rule in two different ways. One of them is saying that the expectation value of rho 0, 0 equal to 0, and another one is saying that the fluctuation and the dissipation term are proportional. Both give the same answer. So now is the final part, and this is the part which I do not have complete answers to, but I will nevertheless say whatever I can. That I have a process where there is a geodesic evolution and there is a noise. It describes the system apparatus interaction very well. Reproduce is a bond rule, and all that happens when the normalization of this geodesic term is related to the normalization of the noise in a well-defined mathematical relation. And that says that there has to be a common origin of the two. Just like the fluctuation dissipation relation which Einstein pointed out in kinetic theory. What kind of mechanism can do that? Relate the geodesic evolution and the stochastic fluctuation, the magnitude which are precisely related. This kind of structure is very common in path integrals and variational principles. And so there should be some underlying dynamics which we should be able to figure out. And this is a strong hint that such a dynamics exists, and you don't have to worry about the rest of the environment. It's between the system and the apparatus. What else? I want to do this job. I have a model for the system, but I need a model for the apparatus. So far, I have not described a model for the apparatus except for saying that it had a pointer string. what could this model be? And we know that all the apparatus which we have, how to convert a quantum signal to a classical pointer observable. So it has to run all the way from the quantum region to classical region, and that is generically some sort of amplifier. Any instrument, you have to amplify the signal, because you can't observe directly the quantum part, you see it at the macroscopic level. And what will be the amplifier which will be most convenient, which connects all the way from the quantum region to classical region, and that is known as a coherent state. It's a continuous interpolation between quantum and classical region without any breakdown. It's just a parameter which takes you, this parameter are called alpha. Alpha equal to 0 is vacuum, and alpha equal to infinity is a apparatus pointer state. And since it's a continuous interpolation, I don't have to assume any new dynamics for it. So apparatus are easy to model as a coherent state. And it's also convenient because most of the apparatus which we have are all based on electrodynamics. And electrodynamics, we know how to define the coherent states, just the annihilation states of this operator, the eigenstates of this A or A dagger. It's eigenstate of A, which gives this coherent state. But coherent states bring something else as a part of it, is that they are not eigenstates of number operator. They always have fluctuations buried inside. It's easy to write down Hamiltonian, which will do that. Just A dagger minus A, it creates a photon or annihilates a photon. If I take a state like this, I can write down an evolution under on-Neimann interaction, which will take the one state to alpha is equal to gt, can be done all the way to infinity. But what does this structure do? And that's a part which I have not fully worked out, a work in progress. But we knowingly or unknowingly build something inside the definition of an amplifier. And that turns out to be important, that amplification will always produce quantum noise when the extracted information is not allowed to return. The best known example of that is spontaneous versus stimulated emission. If the extracted information is allowed to go back, the photon will just get back absorbed in the atom, nothing happened, and you don't have any detection in the instrument at all. So somehow we assume that something came out, the photon came out, but it's not allowed to go back. It produced a cascade and did something else and all kind of non-trivial things, but it never went back to the body. If we assume that, then we have this feature of spontaneous emission, photon came out, it's not going to go back. Stimulated emission is actually the reversible part. You can create a laser and you can absorb all the identical photons which came out back inside the atom without any trouble. But what do you understand these two features as? This is a noise and this is a signal. Simulated part is the amplification of the original signal we had. Spontaneous part is uncontrolled and which is a noise. And again, Einstein told us ratio of two is fixed. You can't fiddle with it. And that is again follows from quantum theory, not from anywhere else. So this is a peculiar feature of amplifiers. Any amplifier, whatever you have, doesn't have to be a linear amplifier, it can be a non-linear complicated thing. It will produce noise whenever you make it irreversible. And the magnitude of the noise is in some sense related to the amount of amplification. And this is what is needed in the theory. It's a question of where is the noise coming from? It says that the noise can come from the process of amplification itself. And remember, this is also a very strong constraint. The amplification occurs between the quantum and the classical level, not anywhere else. It's not something occurring at Planck scale and kicking up something at a different state. It's in the observable range as far as experiments are concerned. Job is to understand it. So it's again a very tight constraint about what the dynamics of this particular noise is. It's there, and it is in observable domain. Technology has to unravel it. How can that become irreversible? There is a feature which is part of many body dynamics that you can have a deterministic evolution of a system which is smooth, and you can have a deterministic evolution. So it turns out that all the amplifiers actually work close to the chaotic boundary. Okay. I don't know whether these microphones are working or not. If you don't tune it right, it will start screeching. That's basically the noise getting uncontrolled. If you want the amplifier to work, you have to work in a region not very far from that. So the amplifiers have a noise, and that noise is close to the chaotic region, chaotic dynamics. Is this chaotic dynamics responsible for the irreversibility which we need? People who design amplifiers actually do address this question. Because we want the signal to come out and not go back. If it is completely deterministic smooth trajectory, there is a likelihood that it can reverse. But if it has gone into chaotic thing, then bring all those random trajectories back into the original process is hard, or rather, it will take an inordinately long time for it to come back, and then you have a good approximation to irreversibility. So this is another feature of classical dynamics which may be useful, and with all these arguments, the question comes back to the beginning, have I solved the measurement problem? The answer is no. I have not solved the measurement problem. But I have taken a step towards understanding it, where I have separated the bond rule from that. The bond rule is basically a fluctuation dissipation type of relation of this noisy process, stochastic process. It will be true for many different kind of noisy process. Different processes will have different kind of noise, and yet the fluctuation dissipation relation will remain valid. The time scales can be very different in different instruments. That doesn't affect this relation, and so on and so forth. So that part of dynamics is removed. The other part of the measurement problem is still there, and that is how did the quantum signal become classical? So that's the question of irreversibility, where I have a suggestion, but not really any fundamental argument or calculation. And this is a problem known in the literature as Heisenberg. When you connect a quantum system all the way to a classical signal, where is the boundary between the two? And what this analysis tells you that the boundary is quite flexible. It depends on the type of interaction between the system and the apparatus, but it will be somewhere. It will obey certain universal properties like bond rule, but it's not dictated by a fundamental constant like Planck's constant, that it is always at this particular location. is not true. It can be variable quantity which separates the quantum and the classical behavior, and in particular you can have situations where Heisenberg cut is not enforced at all, and you can have macroscopic system with quantum behavior, for example in a superconductor and things of that sort. So that is completely fine. What I have done is that this cut is somehow buried in this amplification process, which I need to understand. And of course, the experimentalists have a new challenge. Can they design amplifiers that will violate this fluctuation-dissipation relation? If they do that, then they will have a quantum dynamics which will violate Born's rule. Okay. I don't know whether it is possible or not, but for the experimentalists, it can be an open question. And essentially, that's all I have to say. So I will end with one last amusing connection, that who was responsible for emphasizing the fluctuation-dissipation relation or the spontaneous stimulated emission relation? It was the man who called quantum mechanics incomplete. And you can't afford to ignore him. It's going to come back different ways, different angles, but there are parts which are missing in quantum mechanics, and you don't know where the answers are going to come from. Thank you. So the equation which I showed for a qubit with an exact solution with all the pictures, it was written out by Nicolas Dissan, 1984. Okay, so it's quite old. What I added to it is basically breaking up this evolution into two parts, which I call the geodesic and the noise, and showing that there is a fluctuation dissipation type of relation between the strength of these two terms. Other than that, the subject is quite old, and the new part, which is not yet shown, is the experimental test of this quantum trajectory distribution, which can now be made with big measurements. As I said, the solution was there in this paper. Not 90s, it's 80s. The equation has been there in the literature for a long time. Okay. What extra thing I added, as I said, is a connection to a fluctuation-dissipation relation, which I have not seen anywhere in the literature. If I am wrong, please correct me. And other thing is the comparison with the experimental data, which don't know anything about this trajectory equations. If it works, it's great. As I said, there are lots of different candidates, lots of different theories, and the job of the experimentalist actually is to narrow down the answers among many possibilities to one which will be a best solution to the problem.
Any more questions?
Any amplifier is fine. As I said, it's a work in progress, and I have not done a complete job on the amplifier, and there are a lot of techniques involved in it. In practice, most of the amplifiers are nonlinear, and we don't really have a good theory to describe them either. But what I want to understand is the connection between fluctuation and dissipation, which will be somehow more general than the specific design of a particular amplifier. Which amplifiers are? They do have a noise. The noise is suppressed all the way, but there is a certain minimum quantum noise which you can. You can do that asymmetric amplification also in quadrature. But to get the signal out, you have to basically look at some kind of conjugate variables to determine this trajectory. The trajectory description ends up getting some jiggling behavior. It's not classical measurement because of some peculiarities which are there in this type of fluctuations. As I said, these weights are there, but they are not bounded in the interval 0 to 1. So they are not really probabilities, and so you want to count them as classical variables. You will run up into some conflict here somewhere or the other. But yeah, the generic methods which are involved in this analysis are all borrowed from classical statistical mechanics. Just have to be a little careful about what assumptions you make.